Hello, and welcome to another Short Puppet Review. Today, I am going to talk about the new Disney movie, A Wrinkle in Time. No. Excuse me?
We are not doing a short review on one of the greatest pieces of children's literature and science fiction ever written.
We're not?
Oh, no.
Sit.
No.
No.
My childhood was heavily science-driven, and that was thanks to Star Wars, Star Trek, and A Wrinkle in Time. We are not making some mamby-pamby 5-minute review.
So a team effort?
Sure, I'm up for that.
Hey, Chester, you want to join us?
No, that's okay. I was with RJ when the first adaptation came out. You know, once was enough.
Figured he wouldn't. He's such a chicken.
I think I should be scared right now.
Time is certainly one of those novels that struck a hard chord with me when I read it as a child, and that definitely has not changed through today. The controversial tale of the light and the dark that Madeline L'Engle portrayed is full of redefining stereotypes, challenging what it means to be a children's novel, and cramming it with a whole lot of science and theoretical theories, playing with the what if of many of those theories. And although it is the first book in a quintet series surrounding the Murrays, A Wrinkle in Time stands out from the others. It's kind of like, Narnia's The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe in that aspect. Sure, the other stories are good and decent, but they will never recapture the pure phenomenon that one solid work put out into the world. The book is such an intricate balance between science and fiction, light and dark, and adult themes written in a way that a child can understand them. It's actually quite an incredible feat, and one that wasn't as perfectly recaptured within the sequels or in the original adaptation. Yeah, that's right, Disney's done this before. In 2003, ABC made a television film adaptation of the book, and at the time, it did receive a Best Feature Film Award in Canada, even though it had atrocious reviews. Even Madeline L'Engle herself didn't expect much from the adaptation and wasn't surprised when it wasn't that good. I saw the 2003 version back when I was a kid, and around the time I was super into the whole Wrinkle in Time series, and although I didn't think it was bad, it certainly wasn't good. It kind of reminded me of going back to Narnia, the BBC series adaptation of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, where the low TV budget and the hokey writing fails to immerse you into the universe and therefore doesn't keep you invested in the story or the characters. Going into this, I was hoping that, like The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, Wrinkle in Time would receive this bigger budget and therefore a more fleshed out and more accurate adaptation. I wasn't expecting it to be exactly like the book verbatim because copyright and politics and all of that fun stuff. But if the key elements of the book are there and the main story is presented properly, then I'd be okay. And I like the change of having a more diverse cast. The Murrays were explicitly described in the book, but I always very much saw Meg as this every girl. An intelligent, somewhat down-on-herself middle schooler that went through this mind-blowing journey to understand that you don't have to be the most powerful or the chosen one to change the world. In a way, her psychic-like younger brother, Charles Wallace, is more of the chosen one, and he's the first one to fall into the darkness and it was Meg's unconditional love for her sibling that ultimately saved them.
You were the chosen one!
Was that really necessary?
Yes.
Alright, reference bat. You want to input anything?
I know nothing about the books.
You never read them?
Nope, nothing. Nada. Zilch.
Okay, take it. You're gonna need it.
Oh, cool! A new book!
well-known book, the movie was certainly quite the interesting experience. There were a lot of stylistic choices with scenes and the way the science was depicted, but overall it was very weird. I felt like I was on this 2-hour psychedelic trip, and I have no idea where it was going or why it was going that way, only that the characters said that's where it needed to go. And I know that this is based on science fiction, but a lot of the imagery gave me more of a fantasy feeling. It seemed more rooted in the fiction than the science. And the science that is there is so quickly explained I could barely process said explanation. But overall, it was very visually pleasing, and the characters were pretty well grounded, so I had fun.
Oh, good, good. I'm glad you had fun.
Oh no, everyone hit the deck!
While it is true that the visual aspect of the film is very lovely, the overall reviews have been devastating for the film. And for those coming in with no idea of the book context, I can understand why. The book was not well received when it first published for very similar reasons, but that's not the core reason why I think the film falters from potential greatness. It's the same issue I had with the first adaptation, and unfortunately, it's the same one I have now. Okay, I understand that creative liberties needed to be taken and you can't copy the book verbatim. I understand changing around who says certain lines for the sake of giving the bigger celebrities more screen time. And honestly, I was okay with the first 2/3 of the film. Yes, there were small details that irritated me a little, like the fact that the Murray twins, Sandy and Denny's, were taken out completely because while they weren't the main characters, they were the only quote-unquote normal Murray children in terms of intelligence, and thus balanced out the smarts of Meg and Charles Wallace. But no, they're not in this. Fine, that's fine. And yes, the fact that Mrs. Watson was a vibrant young woman instead of this older woman, as described in the book, irked me a little as well, because the point of that appearance was to show that despite looking old to the children, Mrs. Watson was still incredibly young by her standards. Okay, maybe all of that would have been too much to grasp, and you do have a 2-hour long movie that you've got to keep within Lord of the Ring time limits. Fine, I'll accept that. And the film was progressing fine, despite those nitpicks, until Camazotz. Always Camazotz. For some reason, no film portrays Camazotz the way it is in the book, which is this cold corporate-like world. It started good with the children all bouncing the balls at once and focusing on that singular rhythm. That was legitimately terrifying. But then it changed to this beach setting and everything was vibrant and colorful and the unsettling nature of the planet seemed to completely vanish. And then Charles Wallace just switches sides in an instant, like that. One extended hand and that's it. In the book, there's this whole chapter focusing on the kids desperately fighting the rhythm of it by trying things that are not rhythmic. And Charles Wallace struggles to stay with Megan Calvin, and they struggle to keep Charles Wallace with them, but ultimately it fails. And that's when they rescue Meg's father. In the book, she thinks that he's gonna solve everything and fix Charles Wallace, and he can't. He can't even test her properly. And then when he tries to get them out, and Meg fights, they end up stranded on some distant planet where the missus have to go and find them. None of that is in here! And it's such a crucial part of Meg's character arc, and it shows her faults even more than before. She's furious at her father for leaving Charles Wallace and not fixing things, and she's screaming and crying when she realizes she's the only one who can go back and rescue Charles Wallace, and she has to do it alone. And while the Meg in the movie is so close to showing those faults and her struggles, it's not there completely because this pivotal moment that leads up to Meg fighting it with love is not there!
Oh, so the Tesseract is the fifth dimension. That makes sense.
And another thing, I thought that it would was kind of neat to portray it by putting them within the synapses inside of it instead of showing the giant squishy brain that would have cemented the acid trip notion to general audiences even more. But it in the movie is physically violent. It attacks Meg by tossing her around like a rag doll. And that's not what makes it so terrifying. It doesn't have to do anything physical to break people down and have them succumb to it. All it needs to do is exist. And the evil emits and attacks through the mind, the body, and the soul. And for a children's book, that's terrifying to think about. And that the villain is something you can't fight physically or mentally, because it already has you from the moment that you're born. And all you can do is spend your whole life fighting it with love. Those unsettling moments are what makes the story not just a good children's book, but a children's book with intense adult themes of good and evil that are still questioned today. And unfortunately, none of that is in the movie. And for me, that was critical.
Are you done now?
Yes, I'm done.
It sounds like you hated the movie.
No, I don't hate it. Like I said in the beginning, the visuals are breathtaking and the characters are well-grounded and reflect the characters from the book for the most part. But because those key elements in the story are missing, that's what keeps this film from being an okay adaptation to being a great adaptation. You know, maybe Disney shouldn't be the one to adapt Wrinkle in Time. Blasphemy! Well, they've tried twice already. Look, the point is, it's an okay flick. It's this surreal trip that kind of makes your head think, but not too hard, and it's lovely to look at. But if you want to understand the scientific concepts and the core of the story, just read the book, because it's not present in either film adaptation.
Hey, Bosch?
Yeah?
Would you like to read the book again with me?
Yeah, I'd like that very much. It was a dark and stormy night. In her attic bedroom, Margaret Murray, wrapped in an old patchwork quilt, sat on the foot of her bed and watched the trees tossing in the frenzied lashing of the wind. Behind the trees, clouds scuttled frantically across the sky. Every few moments, the moon ripped through them, creating wraith-like shadows that raced along the ground. The house shook. Wrapped in her quilt, Meg shook. She wasn't usually afraid.
Sweet dreams are made of these. Who am I to disagree?